tonight supposed to talk about renal amyloidosis. Of course, we all know that there are more than 30 types of different amyloidosis defined by the amyloidogenic proteins, and we are so lucky, we as nephrologists are so lucky, that only 8 of them affect kidneys. Otherwise, our diagnostic challenge would be really huge. And as we are talking today about paraproteinemia in the kidneys, I will focus only on those two types of amyloidosis, well, in fact, on one type of amyloidosis, which is AM amyloidosis, and is indeed paraproteinemic. What is important to stress that AL amyloidosis, of which amyloidogenic protein is free and abnormal light chains, and very rarely free and abnormal heavy chains, may be a complication of multiple myeloma, which was covered today very, very broadly in different terms. And it may be a kind of a part of spectrum, huge spectrum again covered this morning of different types of paraproteinemic lesions, of kidney lesions in multiple myeloma, including well-known and relatively rare and more or less recently described. And what is more important, that the non-malignant conditions associated, however, with paraproteinemic kidney damage actually are regarded as monoclonal gammopathy of renal significance, with it many different types, like monoclonal immunoglobulin deposition disease, like GM proximal tubulopathy, which was only briefly mentioned today, cryonephritis, proliferative GN, which was tackled, immunodeductoid glomerulopathy, paraprotein associated C3GN, and membranous and fibrillary, everything what was mentioned today. And current view is that amyloidosis, AL amyloidosis, probably better to consider as a not as a part of MGRS, but because of its really huge proportion in the number of other non-malignant conditions, it is regarded actually independent or a little bit apart from monoclonal gammopathy of renal significance. However, the origin, of course, of AL amyloidosis is definitely paraproteinemic. And what is important to mention is that, and it is more or less with regards to the previous discussion, we have polar conditions and many others in between. On one side of the axis is a huge burden of free light chains, paraprotein, and of course it is oftenly associated with a big burden of malignant plasma cells, which is multiple myeloma as such. And on the other side of this axis is very little amount, but of very, well, wrong, or say ugly, or say bad, or say dangerous, according to the concept of dangerous small clones produced a couple of decades ago. So the number of the paraprotein may be very little, but its physical and chemical properties are like that it is immediately scroll and form different types of tubules or fibrils or deposits and damage kidneys. And as you can see on this slide, on the on the right panel, in one patient we can have one small bad clone, two small bad clones, or even three, like here, bad clones, and each of these pathologic clones produce different type of paraprotein with different type of damage, which can be seen in one patient, in one kidney, in one biopsy. Here I just present the most prominent renal AL amyloidosis I've ever seen in my practice. Totally, the renal tissue totally replaced by amyloidosis, but in other cases, which I will show you later, there may be less prominent damage and a combination of two or three types of damage. And to illustrate this idea, I would like to briefly share with you our experience. This is the pathology and clinical data from almost 150 biopsy-proven paraproteinemic kidney damage. And half of them were due to malignancies, mainly multiple myeloma, but as well Waldenstrom disease and even Franklin disease, and another half was non-malignant. As you can see from this slide, the kidney damage is not exactly in parallel with malignant or non-malignant nature of the disease. We can see AL amyloidosis in multiple myeloma, and we can see it in setting of non-malignant paraproteinemic damage. We can see light chain and heavy chain deposition disease in multiple myeloma and as MGRS. We can see proximal light chain tubulopathy in myeloma, and sometimes we can see it without myeloma or with not diagnosed myeloma, because it's very difficult diagnosis. We often can see a combination of, as I mentioned, of two or even three types of kidney damage in one patient with two or three clones. The only, well, say, unique variant which was broadly discovered this morning is Cas nephropathy, which is not seen in any other condition beyond multiple myeloma with a huge secretion of mostly kappa light chain. And now I'm moving to some illustrations of AL renal amyloidosis. And as you can see on this slide, when you diagnose patient with a severe nephrotic syndrome and impaired kidney function, and your pathologist send you a picture like this, there is definitely no doubt, despite this is not congruent, this is hematoxylin eosin, and this is the first performance of renal amyloidosis seen by pathologists. A lot of masses, eosinophilic masses, non-cellular masses in the glomeruli. And the same can be seen by PAS staining, and when pathologists see such a pattern, of course, he or she suspects amyloidosis. The same is about John Silver, suspect amyloidosis and then perform congruent staining and evaluation in a polarized light. But in other cases, when the process of amyloid distribution in kidney is just in the very beginning, you can see just very tiny, rare spots of congruent material, and it is very challenging for pathologists and clinicians to tell this condition from, well, early stage before polarized evaluation, tell this condition between early stage of amyloidosis and, for example, early stage of focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, which is not the case in such situation where the conga positive material is infiltrating almost all tuft, all glomerulus, and even in such situation where the amyloidosis is mostly distributed in the arterial walls. And this is the different clinical type, because when glomerulus is damaged, we have nephrotic syndrome. When vessels are damaged, dominantly we have progressive kidney failure without nephrotic syndrome. And of course, we can observe the combination of these two types and even three types when it is dominantly interstitial deposition of amyloid. And talking about renal amyloidosis, we have not to forget that AL amyloidosis is a systemic disease involving heart, deposition of amyloid material and its specific ACG and FOCG, and unfortunately gross pathology features with a pseudo hypertrophy of left and right ventricles, and it's very important when you differentiate the pseudo left ventricular hypertrophy with the other more common causes of this condition. Gastrointestinal tract, and this is the typical macroglossia, which is not pathognomonic but very, very characteristic for AL amyloidosis, and we have a set of different illustrations of this condition. All I'm showing you is a patient from our evaluated and treated in our clinic. Unfortunately, we have a damage of liver and spleen with a very prominent infiltration of these organs by amyloid, and colon and intestine, which is also very often damaged, producing malnutrition and other clinical symptoms, which are very difficult to manage, unfortunately, especially in a combination of nephrotic syndrome. We can also can observe the deposition of amyloid in lymph nodes and soft tissues. We can have and really very often observe the skin damage. And now on this picture you have you can see the nails of the patients, which are in some cases this is the first symptom of amyloidosis ever, before weakness, before edema, before everything, before heart insufficiency, before everything, and also other skin lesions, and the very, very characteristic raccoon eye, which is often again observed in the patients with AL amyloidosis, mostly AL amyloidosis, and other hemorrhagic and or thrombotic lesions, which can be combined in patients with AL amyloidosis due to the deficiency of 10th factor and secondary thrombocytemia and other disturbances of calculation system. And now we are moving to the final part of my talk. I'm supposed to talk with you about the treatment. It was already mentioned today several times that actually the bortezomib-based regimens are regarded, and it is a recommendation from the International Working Group, are regarded as probably the best treatment for many types of blood malignancies and non-malignant conditions like AL amyloidosis. And of course, it was not the first, because many, many years ago, historically, there were other types of treatment like colchicine, then methylan and prednisone, then more recently, methylan and dexamethasone, and high dose chemotherapy with stem cell transplantation. And the bortezomib based regimen arrived later. And we decided, as our clinic is doing AL amyloidosis for many, many years, we decided to evaluate our experience, to compare our results and match them with the international data. And we selected from more than 100 patients with AL amyloidosis, we observed only those who were eligible for chemotherapy, because we all know that we often can get patients with amyloidosis which is not eligible for any chemotherapy and just is a subject of symptomatic supportive treatment, unfortunately. So those who were eligible for chemotherapy, and you can see from this slide that half of our patients had multi-organ disease, and many of them had also nephrotic syndrome and renal insufficiency, or combination of nephrotic syndrome, renal insufficiency, heart and other organ damage. So you can imagine that most of them were severe patients with multi-organ, not only multi-organ failure, but not only with multi-organ damage, but with multi-organ failure, unfortunately. And because it was retrospective study. We just divided our patients in four subgroups according to the treatment, and again, prednisone was melphalan with prednisone. It was historical. We did not use colchicine ever for this type of amyloidosis, of course, which is obvious. Those who received melphalan and dexamethasone, those who received stem cell transplantation, and those who received different bortezomib-based regimens, and you can see from here that there was some difference in proteinuria, but nothing striking. They're more or less compatible. The groups were more or less compatible. And we evaluated our patients in terms of hematological remission and organ remission. And what we can see that 33% of patients achieved hematologic remission. So it was removal of their paraproteinemia after the chemotherapy. But unfortunately, only one third, so less proportion, achieved also the organ remission. And there was no striking difference between subgroup treatment subgroups, which I mentioned before. And when we compared, between the treatment regimens, we found that analysis of subgroups showed that the rate of hematologic remissions was significantly higher in those patients who received high-dose chemotherapy with a stem cell transplantation, which is not surprising because it's an aggressive treatment which removes very very shortly the pathologic clone from the bone marrow. Unfortunately, that was not the case for the organ remission. And when we evaluated the patient and kidney survival in total, in the treatment subgroups, we found that there was no statistically significant difference between the treatment subgroups, but 5-year survival in bortezomib-treated subgroup was little bit better. And when we separated our results and divided, as we nephrologists often do, and evaluated separately patient survival and kidney survival, we found that there was some interesting differences. And what is looking more or less like the results of other investigators, that bortezomib-based regimen showed tendency to better 5-year patients, but not kidney, in contrast to what was mentioned about the nephroprotective effect of bortezomib. We did not find that, but survival was definitely better. And the melphalan dexamethasone and stem cell transplantation tended to have higher kidney survival, but not patients, which means that probably it's not reasonable because we are not interested in kidney survival without patient survival, of course. And we conclude that currently recommended treatment regimens, which include all three options I mentioned, in our experience were similarly effective in terms of cumulative patients and kidney survival, despite the high rate of hematological remissions in patients who receive aggressive chemotherapy. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I would like to thank my teachers, collaborators, co-workers, colleagues, and patients for their impact to our research. And with this, I would like to stop, and I'm ready to take your questions. Thank you.